إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. All praise is due to Allah. We praise Him and seek His assistance. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil within ourselves and from the evil of our deeds. Whomsoever Allah guides, none can misguide him. Yet whomever He allows to go astray, none can guide him. And I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship except Allah alone. He has no partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His servant and His messenger. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. O you who believe, fear Allah as He should be feared, and do not die except in the state of Islam. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. O you who believe, fear Allah and speak the truth. He will direct you to do righteous good deeds and will forgive your sins. And whomsoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, he has indeed achieved a great achievement. أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters in Islam, today we want to address an extremely important topic in Islam. It is one of the most important things in Islam, but most people are not aware of that. Most people think it is from the actions that you do after you complete what is obligatory. Most people believe that this is from the mustahabbat or the sunan, that once you finish your salah, once you finish your hajj and your qiyam and your siyam, if you have time left over, then you should do this. But that is not the case. It is one of the most important things in Islam, and it is one of the most essential, it's one of the foundations of who the believing man or woman is. Our topic for the khutbah today is akhlaq, good manners, the importance of akhlaq. There are so many ayat and so many ahadith that point to the importance of this topic. But as we said, so many people believe that it's something that you do as something that's mustahab, a sunnah. When you finish everything else, then you do the or you improve and you perfect your good manners and your character and you're kind to people. But we see from many hadith and ayat, Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, when He's mentioning why He sent the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alamin," and we have not sent you except as a mercy to the universe. So here, no doubt we can understand how the Prophet ﷺ was sent as a mercy. Because it's through what he teaches us that we can avoid the hellfire, wal'iyadu billah. And it's through what he teaches us that will take to paradise. So we can all understand how the sending of the Prophet ﷺ is a mercy in the next life. But no doubt we'll all agree that the Prophet ﷺ being sent is a mercy in the next life, but in this life as well. And in this life, you cannot have mercy amongst human beings if you do not have good akhlaq. If we were to take the example of a village, and in this village, every aspect of bad akhlaq exists. There is envy, there is hatred, there is jealousy, there is backbiting, there is cursing, there is cussing. Every aspect of bad akhlaq, and no good akhlaq in this village. Can you describe this village as being a place of mercy or a merciful village? No. Because in order to have mercy, you have to have good akhlaq. So when Allah Azza wa Jal says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, in this ayah is an indication to the importance of akhlaq, to the importance of good manners. Likewise, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself explains why he was sent, and he could say that he was sent to teach people the Quran, he was sent so people would pray, he was sent to eradicate shirk, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. Verily, I was sent to perfect the most noble of good character, of manners. So it's as if the wording he's using, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's as if he was only sent to improve people's akhlaq. Why? to show us the importance of akhlaq. And good manners and good dealings with other people, it is something that will give you success in every aspect in life, in raising children, in being a good teacher, in being a good businessman, in dealing with your wife, and for the wife dealing with her husband. Everything depends on good akhlaq. And your success in this dunya is linked to good akhlaq. And for that reason, we find Imam Malik rahimahullah, when he was a young boy and he wanted to start learning knowledge, his mother gave him advice. She told him, go to Rabi'at al-Ra'i, the scholar of Medina. اذهب إلى Rabi'ah, فتعلم من أدبه قبل علمه. Go to Rabi'ah and learn from his adab, from his manners, before you learn from his knowledge. And we've probably all seen people who have gained a lot of knowledge as far as information, but they're very rude and they're very harsh, and dealing with them is a difficult experience. And nobody wants to sit and learn knowledge from them. Not only that, but we have the best message ever, which is the Qur'an. The Qur'an, the best message ever, would not have been accepted by the Sahaba, and they have the best hearts ever. If it came packaged with bad akhlaq, they wouldn't have accepted the message. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Qur'an, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيذَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّ مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. And if you were crude or harsh and hard-hearted with them, the companions, they would have scattered from around you. They wouldn't sit to learn from you. So that means even though this message is so great, and these people who are willing to accept it are so great, they wouldn't accept this message if it came packaged with bad akhlaq. So in order to be successful in anything, you have to have good akhlaq. And in the akhirah, you need to have good akhlaq, as we will see inshallah. So Imam Malik, his mother gives him this advice to learn from the manners of Rabi'at al-Ra'i before he learns from the knowledge. Because if he has knowledge and no manners, who will want to sit with him? Who will want to deal with that type of person with bad manners? But then we see the effect of this advice of Imam Malik's mother, rahimahullah. Later on, one of the students of Imam Malik, a brilliant, brilliant man, who gained all of the knowledge of the Imam in the first year. He studied with the Imam for 20 years. In the first year, he learned everything that the Imam had. But yet he remained for 19 years, and everything was repetition to him. So they asked him, why did you remain for 19 years, even though you gained all of the Imam's knowledge in the first year? He said, I remained for 19 years learning from his akhlaq. He was an ocean in manners. The way he dealt with a fellow scholar, the way he dealt with an ignorant person, the way he dealt with a child, the way he dealt with the governor or the ruler. Every day and every experience and every dealing of his was a lesson in akhlaq. So this great scholar studied with him for 20 years, 19 of it was just to learn from his akhlaq. But then he says something more profound. He says, and I wish all of the 20 years was just learning from his akhlaq. He said, I wish even that first year was just to learn from his akhlaq. And when we look at the ahadith, every time you see a hadith that mentions a great reward, you think it's going to talk about something great like salah, or like siyam, or like hajj, or like jihad. But the hadith goes back and it mentions the greatness of akhlaq. The Prophet ﷺ said, the most complete of believers in iman, what do they do? The best of them in manners. The closest of people to me on the Day of Judgment, the best of them in manners. The most beloved of people to Allah Azza wa Jal, what do these people do? Qiyam, salah, the best of them in manners. The Prophet ﷺ said to his companions, خَيْرُكُمْ, the best amongst you, خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ, the best of you are the best of you to their families. And the scholars explain why the Prophet ﷺ said the best of you to their families. Why their families specifically? Because the scholars say that if someone has good manners within his home, then it is very probable that he has good manners outside of the home. Because, and we all know people like this, wal'iyadu billah, who were extremely well-mannered and polite and gentle in the masjid. But in their homes, it's a different story. They even use profanity and they curse and they always erupt and lose their temper. So the person who is good with his family, it is very probable that he is also good outside of the house. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ, the best amongst you is the best amongst you to his family. Likewise, one time the Prophet ﷺ was sitting with his companions. So he asked them a question. He said, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ الْمُفْلِسِ? Do you know who is the one who is bankrupt? قَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ الْمُفْلِسُ فِينَا مَنْ لَا دِرْهَمَ لَهُ وَلَا مَتَاعٍ. They said, O Prophet of Allah, the one who is bankrupt amongst us is the one who has no dirham, no currency, no money, and no possessions. So then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam explained to them that the one who is bankrupt is the one who comes forth on the Day of Judgment with a lot of good deeds. He comes forth with a mountain of good deeds, but he has also come forth with bad manners. He has insulted this person, and he has hit that person, and he took the wealth of that person, and he might have killed this other person. So what happens? This person will take from his good deeds, and then that person will take from his good deeds, and then when his good deeds expire, so these are believers now that he offended in this dunya, they will come and start to take from his good deeds because he offended them, he insulted them, he hit them. When his good deeds expire, he will begin to take from their bad deeds. And the Prophet ﷺ explained at the end of the hadith, then he will be thrown back into the hellfire. So we see the importance of good manners from this hadith. The man came with a mountain of good deeds. So perhaps he gave so much of his wealth in sadaqah. Perhaps he prayed fajr in the masjid every single day. Perhaps he prayed qiyam. He fasted Ramadan, obligatory fast. He went to hajj, he went to umrah. He did so many of the extra good deeds. But he had bad manners. And because of his bad manners, they killed and destroyed all of his good deeds. So it can't be then that good manners is just something from the mustahabbat, from the extra good deeds that you do if you have time left over. It is one of the most important things. And beware, beware, brothers and sisters, beware from offending your fellow Muslims. Beware of that. Because if they don't forgive you in this dunya, and Allah Azza wa Jalla will forgive you for what you err against Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you err against your believing brother or sister, make sure you get their forgiveness from them in this dunya, before they take it from the most beloved thing to you in the akhirah, before they take it from your good deeds. But if we contemplate this hadith some more, where does this happen? This tasfiyah, the settling of accounts between the believers, where does this happen? This happens in front of the gates of Jannah. So what does that mean then? All the believers gathered in front of the gates of Jannah. Before the gates of paradise are opened, then the Muslims will be called one by one, because no one goes into Jannah having issues with his brother or his sister. So everything is settled between people. So it happens before the gates of Jannah. So what does that mean? That means this man, the Muflis, who had so many good deeds in the beginning, he passed through so many stages to make it in front of the gates of Jannah. Because as you know, if someone doesn't have good deeds, death itself is a very difficult experience, the soul leaving the body. But he had a lot of good deeds, so perhaps he passed through this first difficulty of death. And then the grave, the questions of the grave, only the believers and the people of good deeds can answer. Perhaps he passed through that stage as well. And then there is the torment of the grave, and he made it past that stage as well. Then there is the day of resurrection. For 50,000 years, people stand with the sun 1 mile away from their heads. And for the people of good deeds, it will seem like a very short day. And to varying degrees, as people have worse deeds, the day becomes, it's longer and longer and longer. So he may have made it past that stage as well, that difficulty as well. Then there is the questioning and standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know that difficulty. He made it past that stage. And then he started to cross the bridge, the sirat, that's over the hellfire. You cross this bridge and you make it all the way to in front of the gates of Jannah. So this bridge, the Prophet ﷺ described it in the hadith, that it's thinner than a human hair, sharper than a sword, and it's as if Allah gave it a mind of its own. It's craftier than a fox. And some people will have a lot of difficulty crossing over the sirat. Some people will try to crawl, some people will fall off of it. And if those who have good deeds will pass it very quickly. Some people like the bolt of lightning. Others like the blink of an eye. Others like a fast racehorse. Some will run, some will walk, some will crawl, and some will fall. So this man made it past that stage, and now he's in front of the gates of paradise. And then his bad manners catch up with him. When they call him in front of everyone, who has a right to take from him? Then the believers come that he has insulted and offended, and then they start to take from his good deeds. Then he takes from their bad deeds. Then he is thrown into the hellfire. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. So it can't be that akhlaq is not one of the most important things in Islam. Not only that, but to stress the importance of akhlaq, we see that one of the wisdoms and one of the benefits of all the acts of worship is that they're supposed to impact your akhlaq. One of the wisdoms and one of the benefits of doing an act of worship is that it's supposed to impact your akhlaq. Allah Azza wa Jalla says about salah in the Quran, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Establish the salah. Salah prohibits the sins and the reprehensible acts. Bad manners are included in the reprehensible acts. Concerning Hajj, Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ. So there's no vain talk, there's no argumentation in Hajj, which is bad manners. Likewise, with fasting. We know that when someone is fasting and someone fights with you or curses you, you say, إِنِّي صَائِمْ إِنِّي صَائِمْ. I am fasting, I am fasting. We have the act of worship and the effect it's supposed to have on your akhlaq. So it can't be that akhlaq is not one of the most important things in Islam. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which of the deeds most leads people to paradise? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded, taqwa wa husnul khuluq. Piety, being God conscious, and having good manners. These are one of the things that, two things that most lead people into paradise. Taqwa and having good manners. Then Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what are the things that most lead people into the hellfire? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded, the mouth and the sexual organs. The mouth, and what comes out of the mouth again? Bad akhlaq. So we see good akhlaq, one of the things that most take people to paradise. Bad akhlaq, one of the things that most take people into the hellfire, wal'ayadu billah. So with that, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to improve our akhlaq and to perfect our good character. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم من جميع الذنوب فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. Ask Allah عز وجل for His forgiveness. Surely those who ask for His forgiveness shall prosper. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. عائشة رضي الله عنها narrates that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that verily a believer attains with his good manners the same degree as that attained by fasting and establishing salah. With good manners you can attain the same degree as that established by fasting and establishing salah. And because of the hadith that we saw, the man who lost all of his good deeds because of his bad manners, one of the early Muslims and one of the wise men, Yahya ibn Mu'adh rahimahullah, he used to say that good deeds do not compensate for bad manners, while good manners may compensate for bad deeds. He's saying that good deeds will not make up for your bad manners, just like we saw in the hadith. The man came forth with a lot of good deeds, but he also came forth with a lot of bad manners, and his good deeds did not avail him. So your good deeds do not compensate for bad manners. But then he says, rahimahullah, and good manners may compensate for your bad deeds. And because we have a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describes that the heaviest thing on your scale, and you would imagine it to be qiyam, you would imagine it to be siyam, you would imagine it to be hajj, but the heaviest, the most dense of your good deeds, the heaviest thing on your scale on the Day of Judgment is good manners. So your good manners could make up for your bad deeds. So brothers and sisters, beware of offending your believing brothers and sisters in this dunya. Beware of that. Do not do that. And if you have offended anyone, seek forgiveness. It is not worth losing your good deeds on the Day of Judgment. It is not worth many people coming up to take from you in front of the gates of paradise. For that reason, Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah, the great scholar, one time he heard that a group of people were saying bad things about him, or backbiting him and insulting him and so on and so forth. So he sent them a bowl of dates as a gift with a message saying, I heard that you have assigned to me, yet you have given me some of your good deeds. I could not find anything with which to thank you besides this bowl of dates, so please accept it from me. Because he knows that they're giving him from his good deeds. So don't even talk about anybody, especially someone that you dislike. Because then you're giving this person that you dislike one of the most beloved things to you, your good deeds. Also, one of the scholars came to Sufyan al-Thawri as well, rahimahullah, and he told him, I have never seen Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, Imam Abu Hanifa, backbiting or speaking bad about anyone. So Sufyan al-Thawri tells him, yes, Abu Hanifa, أعقل من أن يسلط على حسناته من يذهب بها. Abu Hanifa is more wise than to allow someone to go away with his good deeds. So silence is one of the most important things. The Arabs used to say, keeping silent preserves reverence. People revere you the more silent you remain. And Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhu, he used to say, الكلام كالدواء, that talking is like medicine. إن أقللت منه نفع وإن أكثرت منه قتل. He used to say that speaking is like medicine. If you give a little of it, it cures. And if you give too much of it, it kills. So with that, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to improve our akhlaq and to make us of those who are of the best of character. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our fasting and our good deed during the month of Ramadan and to assist us in reaching the next Ramadan as well. We ask Allah azza wa jal to give victory to Islam and to the Muslims. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant freedom to all the Muslims who are being held unjustly around the world. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to not make the dunya the greatest of our concerns. Ya Allah, do not make the dunya the greatest of our concerns. Ya Allah, do not make the dunya the greatest of our concerns. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us of those who hear the speech and follow the best of it. And we ask Him to send His salah and salam upon His final messenger, Muhammad, and upon His family and those who follow them upon righteousness until the day of resurrection. فَاللَّهُمَّ أَبْرِمْ لِهَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ أَمْرَ رُشْدٍ يُعَزُّ فِيهِ أَهْلُ طَاعَتِكَ وَيُهْدَى فِيهِ أَهْلُ مَعْصِيَتِكَ ويؤمر فيه بالمعروف وينهى فيه عن المنكر يا سميع الدعاء وصل اللهم وبارك على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وقوموا إلى صلاتكم من حرمكم الله